All right, welcome to the Real Health Guide to the Ketogenic Diet webinar. I just wanted to put that title up there so you know that you're in the right place. I'm your host, Dr. Taylor Crick of the Real Health Resource. And this webinar is really a follow-up to an ebook that I've written called The Real Health Guide to the Ketogenic Diet. And so the book is great, very informative, but I want to troubleshoot some of the things that we've seen patients and clients run into. And some of the things that I've learned in my own life on how to safely and effectively and really most beneficially execute a ketogenic diet. So I'm going to talk about, you know, what is a ketogenic diet? What is a ketone? What is ketosis? I'm going to talk about some of the research behind the ketogenic diet that's coming out today, which is fascinating. And I'm going to talk about what do you eat? How do you measure it? And everything that you need to know about how to get into a ketogenic diet. But first, you know, where this stemmed from was, you know, really learning about this myself. And so I want to share a couple stories before we get into some of the research behind a ketogenic diet. So a ketogenic diet, first off, if you're not familiar with it, you've just heard a recent buzz term. Ketogenic is when your body is burning fat. When your body burns fat, when it mobilizes fat, it produces something called ketones. And you can think of this like, you know, if you burn wood, you get smoke. When you burn fat, you get ketones. So that is what a ketogenic diet is. Now, when I started doing a ketogenic diet, I was immediately turned on because when your body burns ketones, they're a preferred fuel source for your brain. And so my brain, I've never felt the kind of clarity, the kind of sharpness, the kind of, you know, clear sleep, waking up without an alarm. I just felt great and felt amazing. And a lot of people echo this. And so since I've written my ebook and, you know, kind of built my expertise somewhat around the ketogenic diet recently in my own personal life, you know, I do different talks out in the community and things like that. And I want to tell you, I was doing a talk at Natural Grocers, and the vitamin manager there, she said, you know, she was introducing the talk and she said, "Do you want to hear my keto miracle story?" I said, "Yeah, absolutely, of course." And she said in 1991, she was going 150 miles an hour on the back of a motorcycle, rear-ended somebody, and, you know, flew how many feet, you know, crazy, crazy story, traumatic brain injury. Okay, lost her ability to do many things, lost her ability to walk, lost her ability to do lots of things. She says one of her first memories was her mom handing her a roll of toilet paper, and she says, "What is this for?" And they told her parents that she would never progress past a three-year-old mentality. But long story short, she got herself, you know, back functioning and relatively healthy. But when she looked down, she would see double. So it was impossible to walk. She couldn't hike. And she couldn't read. She didn't read for 18 or 20 years. Anyway, a friend was telling her that he wanted to try a ketogenic diet for weight loss. She was trained in the traditional food pyramid, you know, grains as the base, carbs as the base, you know, way of eating. And she started doing research on the keto diet to talk her friend out of it. And in doing her research, she came across all the things about brain health and brain inflammation, and executed and implemented a ketogenic diet. And long story short, she's perfectly normal now. She's been following it for a year and a half to 2 years, perfectly normal. You would never have any idea. Traumatic brain injury healing, you know, to some degree with the ketogenic diet. And I'm going to explain some of the research behind that. But what I've noticed in my own life is similar. It's not nearly as drastic, but I have lost my sense of smell for, you know, at least 6 years. And I never knew what it was: toxicity, subluxation of the spine, you know, a combination of all of the above. But lately, I had somebody ask me, you know, "Did you have any head injury around that time?" And I did have a concussion skiing around the same time, 6 or 7 years ago now, and haven't been able to smell since. Still can taste, just can't smell. But since doing a ketogenic diet, when I'm in ketosis, I can tell because my sense of smell comes back 100%. So I want to share with you guys, you know, some of the research and what this is really doing in your brain before we get into, you know, exactly how to execute the ketogenic diet and what do you eat. So here's an article. This is from PubMed. That's what that address is at the top, which is, you know, all the medical literature, all the scientific literature gets indexed in PubMed. And so this article is from the journal Frontiers in Molecular Neuroscience. And I'm not going to get into every finding in these studies, but this is the title of the study: Can Ketones Help Rescue Brain Fuel Supply in Later Life? Okay, so ketones are a brain fuel. And when your brain runs out of fuel, that is implicated, as you can see there, in, you know, cognitive decline, Alzheimer's disease, dementia. And ketones being a preferred fuel source for your brain can actually help prevent these things. And so this is one of the studies. Here's another one that's just within that study, I believe, or maybe another related one, I can't remember. But ketone bodies have been found to be neuroprotective. They protect your brain cells, and cytoprotective. They protect your cells. You can see there that fasting has been used as an anti-convulsive therapy. The ketogenic diet has been used, its main, you know, application originally was in epileptic children, childhood epilepsies that were drug resistant. It's been used, you know, and most of this comes from Johns Hopkins, but this has been used for over 100 years as the standard of care for kids with seizures and epilepsy because the ketones help protect the brain. Here's another one. This is from the journal Science, one of the most prestigious journals out there. This is saying suppression of oxidative stress. Okay, so we've heard of antioxidants. We know the importance of antioxidants in our food supply, but that's because of oxidative stress. And so this is saying that oxidative stress is suppressed by beta hydroxybutyrate, which basically is ketones. So ketones suppress oxidative stress. The other part of this title here, an endogenous histone deacetylase inhibitor. So in, you know, layman's terms, what that means is HDACs, histone deacetylase, they're used now in cancer research, but they are what's called epigenetic switches, which, you know, some of you have heard that term, that we have good genes and we have bad genes, and these are turned on or turned off by epigenetic switches. That's what that means, that ketones actually help your cells communicate and turn good genes on and can turn bad genes off. But yeah, suppress oxidative stress. That's a huge one. Here's another one that says that the ketogenic diet can promote mitochondrial biogenesis in a mouse model, which just means that your mitochondria are your powerhouses of your cells. And these are just some of the things that the keto diet is being researched for. Here's another one: in vitro ketones protect neurons from MPP, a chemical used to induce Parkinson's in mice, and beta amyloid plaque. That's the plaque that, you know, people may have heard of with Alzheimer's, amyloid plaques forming in your brain. So how does ketosis work? How do you produce ketones? How do you get into ketosis? Well, ketogenic, I just want to define some terms here. Ketogenic is a the description of the diet that produces ketones. When your body, when you followed a ketogenic diet long enough, your body switches into what's called ketosis. So ketosis is a state in which your body is burning fat as its preferred fuel source. Now, you can burn, your cells can burn two things for fuel. They can burn fat or they can burn sugar. And now I'll let you fill in the blanks here. What do you think most Americans tend to run on? They run on sugar. Okay, so they're sugar burners. We are sugar burners. That's why we accumulate fat. When you begin to use fat as your preferred fuel source, you know, the low-fat diet, you know, doesn't work. We know that now. And it's not the dietary fat that makes you fat. It's your body's inability to burn fat because it is a sugar burner. It gets high insulin spikes. Insulin is the fat-producing hormone. So ketosis is a state in which you've transitioned your body, adapted your body to being a fat burner. Okay, so very, very efficient fuel source. Your body can go forever on its own fat stores, not literally forever, but it can go a really long time. And I always use the analogy of, you know, think about if we dumped you on a deserted island, say for 30 days, you would not die if you had water, right? Your body has stores of fuel on it, even though you can't get your carbs, you can't get your breads, you can't get your sugar spike that you might have cravings for the first few days, your body has plenty of energy stored on it in the form of fat. So how does it work to get into this state called ketosis? Well, when it's pretty simple, really. When you don't give it carbs or sugar, your body will start to burn fat. When your body starts to burn fat, it's going to take a little bit of time. We're going to talk about keto adapting. It doesn't do it right away. But when not given carbs or sugar, your body will start to burn fat. When it burns fat, it produces ketones. And then that is, you know, just a good sign that you're in fat burning mode. But it's also a preferred fuel source for your brain. So, you know, I would say that for me personally, weight loss is not, you know, a goal of mine. In fact, quite the opposite. I don't want to lose weight, but I love the ketogenic diet for the brain effects. And I actually talked about this, you know, in one of our testimonials videos that we shot. And this is a patient who lost 120 pounds in 6 months, maybe 115 at the time of the shooting of the video, in 6 months. And so that's a dramatic life change, right? But I asked him, well, what was the biggest change? And he said, honestly, I would say it's the brain. It's the cognitive effects is the biggest thing that, you know, has got me loving this. And he's lost 115 pounds. Huge, dramatic life change. But the cognitive effects are, you know, why I do it. So going back to this, so what do you eat? You know, how do you get into this state called ketosis? And this is, you know, probably the most important concept here, is that it's not about how much fat you eat. It's about limiting the carbs and the insulin response. Okay. And the reason that I say that that is the most important is because even when I first started researching the ketogenic diet, you look at some macronutrient breakdowns, which might say something like your diet needs to be 65 to 85% fat. So it's a very high fat diet. So I was just loading up on fat, which, you know, is a good thing for me because it's high calories, but it's not really about the percentage breakdown of fat versus protein versus carbs. It's more about limiting your carbs and limiting your insulin spikes. So when you eat carbs, when you eat grains, when you eat sugars, any what's called net carbs, and we're going to explain how you can measure net carbs, but when you eat those, your insulin spikes. And the more often your insulin spikes, the less often they, or the less likely you are to get into ketosis. And as soon as you spike that insulin, you are going to shoot yourself in the foot and you're not going to be keto adapting. So to get back to this, what do you want to measure? How many carbs can you have? Well, the number one rule is to consume under 40 grams of net carbs per day. Okay, and I have a slide to show you what is a net carb per day. Now, you can keto adapt at 50. You can keto adapt faster at 30. So you get the point. The, you know, 40 grams is kind of the magic number that I like people to stay under, especially if you're going, you want to transition quickly, which you absolutely do. You don't want to take a long time to get into fat burning mode. You want to do this as quickly as possible. So, and here's a couple of helpful rules to follow. These are from my mentor, Dr. Pompa, and these are just great keto rules. There's a 10 gram, 20 gram, 30 gram, 40 gram, 50 gram rule. That's rule number one. So you can do this. I've had people do this daily. They'll do a 10 gram day, a 20 gram day, a 30 gram day, a 40 gram day, a 50 gram day. Or you can do it weekly. And if you do this for 5 weeks in a row, by the fifth week, you can get your carb count up to 50 grams per day and stay in ketosis. Now, we're going to talk about measuring this. So how can you know that you're in ketosis? The only way is to measure. That's the only, you know, appropriate way to do a ketogenic diet, in my opinion, is to measure it. So I'm going to talk about that. But if you go 10 grams a day for a week, you're going to transition pretty quickly, because that's pretty restricted carb count for a day. And that's, you know, not that easy to do, but definitely possible for a week. So then you go 20, then you go 30, and you're lifting the restriction as you continue to go. So the next rule is the 2-2-2 rule. And this one I would say is a must for anybody wanting to do a ketogenic diet. This is a must, especially the last two is literally a must. But some of the fats that are ketogenic fats are grass-fed butter, and the most ketogenic fat, the fat that's going to put you into ketosis the best and the easiest, is coconut products, coconut oil, MCT oil. Okay, medium-chain triglycerides are very ketogenic, so you can use those in several ways, and I'll talk about those when I talk about a typical keto day. But the 2-2-2 rule is 2 tablespoons a day of grass-fed butter. Okay, so you can cook your eggs in that, you can add it to your coffee. There's a lot of different ways that you can implement butter, grass-fed butter. 2 tablespoons of coconut oil. Same thing, you can eat it off the spoon, you can put it in your coffee, you can cook things with it, you can put it on a salad, you can do a lot of different things. Coconut or MCT oil. MCT, you know, is something that I've been using more of lately, and really, really like it. Very ketogenic, very thermogenic, promotes fat burning. So really good oil. So 2 tablespoons of butter, 2 tablespoons of coconut oil or MCT oil, and this one's really important, 2 teaspoons of sea salt. When your body goes into ketosis, it can throw off mineral and electrolyte balances. So electrolytes include things like salt, sugar, magnesium, sodium chloride in the salt. But the reason that you want to use sea salt and never use iodized table salt is that sea salt usually contains over 80 different minerals. Okay, so different trace minerals, all these different minerals that your body really needs. And when you're doing sea salt, you're only getting sodium, or when you're doing table salt rather, you're only typically getting sodium and chloride. And you need a balance between sodium, chloride, magnesium, all these different electrolytes. You need a good balance. So sea salt is a must while you're keto adapting or transitioning, and the whole time that you're on a ketogenic diet. And your body will tell you this too. You're going to crave salt, but you want to make sure that you intake a lot of water and intake a lot of salt on a ketogenic diet. And that might be counterintuitive to what you've heard in the past, you know, like with typical, you know, lower your sodium, things like that. But when you're eating a real food diet, sodium, first off, is not nearly as big of a concern, because, you know, there's over 100 times more sodium in processed foods than there is in real salt. So it's not nearly as big of a concern. But yeah, add that sea salt in when you're doing the ketogenic diet. Really, really necessary. The other rule, the last rule, is the 5-1-1 rule. Okay, and this is just a really good thing to, you know, keep it fresh, not be doing the same thing every day, and keep your body guessing. This is another rule from Dr. Pompa. It's called diet variation, keeping your body guessing. So 5-1-1. And so what that looks like is 5 days of intermittent fasting, and I'll explain what that is, 1 day of full fasting, and 1 day of feasting. And I'm going to use this rule to talk about a lot of these concepts, because they're awesome strategies for getting into ketosis. So 5 days of intermittent fasting. Well, first off, what does that mean, intermittent fasting? It means fasting on a daily basis for just a certain amount of time. The golden number, I would say, is about 14 hours of fasting to 16 hours. 16 hours of fasting, especially for men, is just a really good number. And so that means that you eat, if you're fasting for 16 hours, you eat during an 8-hour window. So you might skip breakfast, go until 1 o'clock for your, let's say noon, go to noon for your lunch, eat lunch, break your fast, breakfast, break fast, That's what breakfast means. You know, breakfast is not necessarily the most important meal of the day, especially when you're going on a ketogenic diet. You can skip breakfast, break fast at noon. Then you finish eating at, let's say, 6 to 8 o'clock at night. By 8 o'clock, you're done eating and you're fasting again. So that's daily intermittent fasting. Really popular thing these days. We have a great podcast episode on the benefits of intermittent fasting. Been shown to boost human growth hormone dramatically, a fat burning and muscle building hormone, but also helps stimulate ketosis. Any fasting helps stimulate ketosis. And so that's actually the next part of this rule. 5 days a week of intermittent fasting, 1 day a week of full fasting, which means maybe you eat dinner Tuesday night, you finish by 6, 7 o'clock at night, you stop eating, you go the next day 24 hours until dinner. I think dinner to dinner is the best and the easiest way to do this. You can go a full day, you can do every other day fasting where you just don't eat, you eat Tuesday, you don't eat Wednesday. But going dinner to dinner, a full day of fasting is the other one. So remember, it's the 5-1-1 rule. The last one is a day of feasting. And that doesn't mean pizza and ice cream and you know, just stuffing your face, but not following keto principles. You know, maybe you can have some quinoa, maybe you can have some baked potatoes or, you know, soaked potatoes rather than baked potatoes, I would say. But, you know, maybe you have some carbs, maybe you have, you don't look at your 40 grams of carbs, you go up to, you know, 100 or above, and you're feasting. You're letting your body know that it's not starving. So really important concept, you don't want your body to think that it's starving because then it goes into fat storage mode. So you want to stay a fat burner without just purely fasting, because then your body goes into fat storage mode. You want to keep your body guessing. So the 5-1-1 rule, really great to mix it up, to shake it up, and to just not get bored. You know, your feast day is going to be a great day. Your fast day is not that hard. And fasting is the fastest, no pun intended, fastest way to get into ketosis. Okay, so when you're keto adapting, you know, if you're just following a ketogenic diet, it'll take 3 to 4 weeks to adapt to being a fat burner. If you're intermittent fasting, every day you're going 16 hours without eating, and then you're just limiting, you can eat the same amount of calories, just limit it from, you know, a shorter window and fast the rest of the day. It might take you 2 to 3 weeks to adapt if you're pretty strict on your net carbs. And then if you're strict fasting, if you just go without eating, you can go a lot longer. And we just recorded a podcast, an interview with a patient of ours who has a lot of experience with fasting. So I would encourage you to check that out. She's done a 28-day extended strict fast. She's done a lot of different bone broth fasts. She's done master's cleanses. She's done whey water fasts. She's done everything in between, juice fasting. And so very, very experienced with fasting. It's an intimidating topic. We're not going to get into it fully today, but a really fast way to get into ketosis. So going back, net carbs, what does that mean, measuring your net carbs? What that means, so remember, we want to stay under 40 grams of net carbs per day. So you want to track this. You need to track this, you know, and you don't have to track it forever. I'll tell you, for me, I'm not much of a tracker. Once you understand how this works, you don't need to continue tracking, because you start to get a good idea. You start to understand what net carbs are, how many are in different things, what you can have. And also, I'd like to throw in right now, there's a lot of great apps out there. The Keto Diet app is one of my favorites. But now if you go to the app store and you type in ketogenic, you're going to get several different things that list out your net carbs. But it's like a recipe. You might say this recipe has 10 grams net carbs, but you want to get used to measuring this. There's also some apps out there, like Chronometer is one that I use for you know, a couple weeks on a keto diet. I don't do it forever because I think it's annoying to have to enter in all my food. But for a couple weeks, I entered in everything that I was eating. So it would tell me how many calories am I eating, what is the breakdown of fat to protein to carbs, and how many net carbs am I having per day. But what is a net carb? What does that mean? What's the difference between a net carb and a carb? Well, if you see here at the top, net carbs are carbs minus fiber. Okay, so if you look at this nutrition fact right here, this is where you're going to find it. The total carbs, 15 grams. Okay, you don't need to look at the sugars. The dietary fiber is the next thing. 15 grams of total carbs, 3 grams of fiber, so 12 grams of net carbs. And I'll tell you, this is a slice of Ezekiel bread, which is one of the healthier, lower carb breads. It's really pretty low carb. But on a keto diet, let's say I'm going to have a sandwich, which is, you know, basically a no-no. But right there, I'm having 12 grams of net carbs. And you know, I'm a big no eating grains in the first place. So absolutely not on a ketogenic diet. But one of the healthier grains is Ezekiel bread here. But 12 grams of carbs per slice. So in one sandwich, I'm at 24 grams of net carbs. That's going to really either destroy my ketosis, my keto adapting, or it's going to really limit the rest of my day. Because if I'm already at 24 and I want to stay under 40, I've got to really, really watch the rest of my day. So you start kind of allocating these carbs where they can go. And you think, oh, I don't want to have that lunch that has 20 grams of net carbs, because then what am I going to have for dinner? And you start looking and start tracking this. It's really, really important. I'll tell you, you know, some of the things for me were coconut milk. I do a lot of coconut milk smoothies. And so in a can of coconut milk and in a scoop of grass-fed whey protein, pretty low carb, both of them. But right away, there are, you know, 15 to 20 grams of net carbs in a smoothie. And it's a really, really high-fat smoothie. So if you just think that the keto diet is just high-fat and high-protein, just because you're getting high-fat and high-protein, you're getting a lot of net carbs in that smoothie. And my body can absolutely handle that now, and it can handle it especially after or before a workout. You know, you can afford a little more carbs if you're exercising hard. But that's something that I might avoid or might look at. Another thing that was a big eye-opener for me, I looked at different nuts. And pecans have 0 grams net carbs. Almonds have zero, I believe. Cashews, though, were like maybe, I don't remember exactly, 5-6 grams of net carbs per serving, per maybe quarter cup serving. So I stopped eating cashews and started eating more pecans. Macadamia nuts have like 3 grams maybe. So some of these nuts, and you just need to look at them and change them and allocate your 40 grams, you know, where you can. But that's probably the most important concept, is measuring your net carbs, restricting your net carbs, learning what that means and what that looks like, using an app like Chronometer, using an app like the Keto Diet app to measure your net carbs for the day. Because there's no way that you're going to break into ketosis if you're over that number. And I'll tell you, one of the most common things that I see are people saying, oh, I'm eating so low carb, I think I'm doing a keto diet. And they measure their blood, and they're just not even close. You know, you'd be surprised at where these carbs come from and how strict you really have to be. But that's not to intimidate you, because once you are strict for a little bit, like 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, you can loosen it up as your body keto adapts. And I'm to the point now where I can have, you know, total cheat weekend and you know, spike my insulin, get out of ketosis for sure, and then I can get back in pretty quickly because I've followed this for a long time, and you know, through exercise and different things, you can get back into fat burning mode pretty quickly once you're there, once you've kind of primed those pathways. So that's how you measure net carbs. How do you measure ketosis? Well, here's two pictures. One is a urine strip that measures ketones, and those are okay. You know, I know people that have used them and that like them. They're definitely cheaper, but I only really recommend using the blood meter, just because it's not that hard. The meter itself is $25, and the strips are a little bit expensive, but you can get them for $2 a strip, and then when you use, so that's $20, that's not that cheap, but let's say you get $20 for 10 rather, but let's say you get, you know, 10 pack, and you want to measure every weekday, that gives you 2 weeks of measurements. After you follow the keto diet, you can get a pretty good idea, or you can measure 1 week twice a day and kind of see where you're at. So here are my strips that come in a purple package. I also have blood sugar strips here, and that's why you want to use this meter, because you can measure ketones and you can measure blood sugar both on this meter. So this meter, I'll pull up the picture again, is called the Precision Extra. Okay, and the Precision Extra is $25. You can buy it on Amazon, and you can get these strips. The ketone strips you can get, I would say, on eBay. You can get some pretty good deals on eBay, and that's the best place. You know, there's another place called UniversalDrugstore.com, but they don't accept Visa or MasterCard, and it's kind of annoying. So I'm not a big fan of that one, but they are a little bit less expensive. But you can get some good deals on eBay for about $2 a strip. So it looks like this. It's a finger prick. You prick your finger and you measure it. So what you want to see, you want to see ketone levels between 0.5 and about 3. Now you could be above that. You could be above 3, like somebody that's fasting, true fasting. It could be up 7, 8, 9, 10 for sure, especially if they're going a really long time. But 3 is kind of where you lose like the therapeutic benefits. Here's one, I don't know if we can see it. Yeah, that's one of mine, 2.3. Here is a friend of mine that was doing keto, and it was in the office. He was at 0.6. In ketosis, 0.9. There's another one. And, you know, kind of thrown in there are also blood sugar numbers. Here's a 79 blood sugar number. So you can use this. It has a memory, and it tracks your ketone levels. But I do not recommend doing a keto diet without this. I think it's pointless. I've had so many people say, oh, I think I'm in ketosis, and they will measure, and they're just not. And you don't, you know, the ketones in your urine can kind of give you an indication, are you in ketosis or not? But you want to know an exact number. You want to know where you're at on the scale, whether or not you're in mild ketosis or you're in strong ketosis. It's definitely a scale, and it's definitely going to change with things like exercise, with things like fasting. So the best time, I would say, to take these numbers is first thing in the morning or right before your first meal of the day. So say you're intermittent fasting, you could take it at 11:45 and then you eat at noon. But you just want to be consistent with these numbers to kind of know where you're at. You think about it that, like, if you're fasting for 16 hours, at the end of that 16 hours, if your body has not been given sugar, not been given carbs, it's going to be breaking down its fat. That's the goal. So at the end of those 16 hours, it's going to be, you know, breaking down fat, producing ketones. That's the best time to measure when you've fasted. Or if you're doing a full fast day, do a 24-hour fast, measure right before you eat. You want to give yourself the best chance to just know whether, you know, you don't want to do it right after a meal or right after even a workout. You want to give yourself the best chance to know whether or not your body is in this state of ketosis. And when not given any fuel, it's going for its fat source. We use the analogy in the ebook of a hybrid car that can use gas or it can use electric. The gas gives it a short burst of fuel. It can maybe go a little bit faster, but it's not very efficient, and that's your sugar. You want to be running on electric. You want to be high efficiency. You want to be producing ketones, and you have to measure it with the blood meter. So there's the rules again, the helpful rules to follow. The 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, the 2, 2, 2 rule, and the 5, 1, 1 rule. And here's an example is, let's say on Wednesday, you fast dinner to dinner. You either go all day Wednesday or you eat dinner Tuesday night and you go until dinner Wednesday night. Then Thursday, you intermittent fast. Friday, you intermittent fast. Saturday, you feast. You load up. You don't restrict, you eat breakfast, you have some healthy carbs, healthy being the key word there, and let your body know that it's not starving. Then you intermittent fast Sunday, Monday, Tuesday until dinner, and you repeat that. So those will help you break into ketosis. And here is a typical keto day for me. Now, one of the things about intermittent fasting that really confused me, and I want to stop and talk about this for a second, is it's not that you have to eat nothing, it's that you don't want to spike your blood sugar at all. So you can do a bulletproof coffee, which is MCT oil or grass-fed butter, into your coffee in the morning, and it doesn't spike your blood sugar. Now, for some people, coffee alone will spike your blood sugar. So that's why, you know, I think it's super important to not just measure ketones, but equally as important to measure blood sugar and to know where you're at there to see how you react to different foods. Coffee, for example, no carbs in it, but some people, their cells are just so sensitive, or they're so kind of, they're metabolically broken, that coffee will actually spike their blood sugar. Or, you know, eating even fats, no carbs, will spike their blood sugar. And that'll change. That'll change over time to where coffee can actually decrease your blood sugar. But the only way to know is to measure and to see where you're at in a fasting state. When your blood sugar drop, you want to see ketones rise. There's a weird graph there. But as your blood sugar drops, that's when you get hangry. But that's only because your ketones don't rise. If your blood sugar drops and your ketones rise at the same time, you start to feel amazing. So that's why measuring and knowing, you know, is so important. So fasting, it sounds like you want to eat nothing. And that is, you know, true fasting. That is the definition of fasting. But in this sense, for a ketogenic diet, fasting, you can still have some coconut oil. You can still have some butter, perhaps. You can still have some MCT oil for sure and still be considered fasting. So here's a typical keto day, starting off with coffee. And so I'll tell you what I do, and I love it. So I'll have a cup of coffee, and I'll put MCT oil in it, coconut oil, or grass-fed butter. And I rarely put all three, but sometimes I do. But most often I'll put grass-fed butter and MCT oil. I put it in the Vitamix, and I blend it. That is the most important part, because when I first heard about this, you know, it's called bulletproof coffee. There's branding behind it now, which is awesome. But you can Google that. You can look it up. It's really, really popular. Now, this is not doing anything for you if you're still eating high carbs. You do bulletproof coffee and an English muffin, and you're storing fat. You're just adding calories. You're spiking insulin while getting, you know, so those fats. Those fats are ketogenic, though. So if you're fasting, especially, they're going to help you burn fat. But if you at the same time spike your blood sugar, they're not. They're going to help your body store fat. But bulletproof coffee, when I first put it in the coffee and tried it, I was like, this is nasty. But when I blended it, it froths it up like a latte. It's amazing. It's really, you know, quite a treat. And I have, you know, dozens and dozens of patients that do this and love it, and friends, and it's just kind of becoming the norm to blend this up. Sometimes I'll put a little bit of full fat coconut milk in there, but that does have some carbs in it. So that might be on my feast day. Usually I try to keep zero carbs and, you know, put a little cinnamon in it, spice it up, but put it in the blender, froth it up really quickly, and it's delicious. So that might be how I started the day, or how, you know, many keto meal plans would have you start the day, with a bulletproof coffee to give your body some ketogenic fats to start that fat burning process. What happens is, as your body burns those fats, when it runs out of fuel, it looks for other fat to continue burning. So it's going to look for your fat. So then from 7 to say 12, you intermittent fast, which means you don't eat anything. And that's going to be, you know, if you've never heard this before, it'll be hard for, like, you know, I don't know, a few days, a week or so. But so many of us, we spike our blood sugar and then it crashes. So we get that 10 o'clock craving, we get hangry, we need a snack, we feel brain fog, we get irritable. That is a really, really bad sign that you have poor blood sugar control. So the only way to break that is to just break it. So intermittent fast until, say, noon. You know, and when you start running on your own fat, you don't get nearly as hungry. You're not going to be getting the blood sugar spikes and crashes. And watch the blood sugar webinar if you want to learn more about spikes and crashes of blood sugar. But you're going to be running on your own fat. You know, you should be able to go till, you know, 2-3 in the afternoon and hardly notice that you haven't eaten. And when you're on a ketogenic diet, your cravings go down dramatically. But you'll forget to eat sometimes, and that is a good thing, because your body is running off its fat stores. It's not saying feed me sugar, feed me sugar, feed me sugar. Really good sign when your cravings start to go down. So intermittent fast till, let's say, noon, 1, 2, whatever time, depending on what time you stopped eating dinner the night before. Then let's say maybe you have, you know, eggs and avocados. Now, if you're out at your office or something, that might not be possible, but that's just a really good one. Very, very low net carbs. Let's say you have 4 eggs scrambled and half an avocado, and you can cook it in butter. You want to put your sea salt on it for sure. You can put something that's really high fiber, like spinach, on there. And that's the thing too that I'll mention before we get to this big keto salad. Actually, now I'll talk about that, because when you look at your net carbs, like we talked about, one of the biggest mistakes that I see people make is they don't have enough plants on a keto diet. It is high fat. It is moderate protein, I would call it. But your leafy greens, you can still eat a ton of those. They're really, really, really high in fiber. So salads are absolutely a keto staple. And if you get sick of salads, you've done a diet before and you get sick of salads, you know, you might be in for tough luck. You know, you can put salmon on it, you can put beef on it, grass-fed beef, you can put chicken on it, you can put bison on it. You don't have to do meat. You can do a vegetarian keto. You can do, you know, MCT oil drizzled on it as your salad dressing. You can do olive oil, great fat. You can do olives, great fat. You can do crunched nuts. You can do raw cheeses shredded on there, only raw for the dairy, in my opinion. You can do cashew cheese. You can do some softer cheeses like fettas or a little bit, you know, better. But the leafy greens are a must. You need to keep high in the leafy greens. So lettuce wraps, salads, really, really good thing. High fiber there. So that might be your dinner. And I would say this might turn some people off, but I would say I have a salad daily. But I don't think that it should turn you off, because it's always different. It's grass-fed beef, it's bison, it's wild-caught salmon, it's organic chicken. So different protein source in there. Grass-fed beef, salmon, also good fat sources, healthy omega-3s in there. Saturated fats in the grass-fed beef. Then maybe a bed of spinach, kale, lettuce, you know, romaine if I'm doing lettuce wraps, spinach or kale, or kind of, you know, greens mix. And you could change that up. There's a ton of varieties there. Maybe you do some raw cheese, some grass-fed cheese shredded on top of your salad. Olive oil, MCT oil, avocado oil is another great one. Ground nuts, cut up olives. You know, you can do just a massive, massive variety here. So that is, you know, I would say on a daily basis, you know, a salad is a good idea. And that might sound like, you know, your diet in the past, salads, or you're eating rabbit food. But, you know, that's not the keto diet. It's really high fat. So you just want to put all these great toppings on, change it up. No balsamic vinegar, no ranch dressing, no Thousand Island. You know, you're keeping the carbs to a low, but you're keeping the fiber and fat at a really high end. So that's a really just typical keto day. Now, I would highly recommend something like I mentioned, the Keto Diet app or Keto Diet Resource. There's different websites. You know, we don't have a keto cookbook necessarily, but there's just a ton of different recipes. Most of the recipes that we have are keto. You know, we make great things like great keto desserts, almond flour, coconut flour, sweetened with stevia or erythritol or sometimes xylitol, or you know, no sweetener. And you can make really great keto desserts. You can make really great, you know, keto snacks. You can make really great keto, you know, muffins and all kinds of grainless pancakes and things like that. There's all kinds of recipes out there. But just like anything else, you know, you're gonna have to do some research. You're gonna have to do some looking into this, and you're gonna have to learn how to use these things, because, you know, if you're just switching over to coconut flour or almond flour and you're not used to it, it's not the same as cooking with regular white flour and sugar. It's gonna take some experimenting, but there are a ton of resources out there for your recipes and the foods that you can eat. I would start with the Keto Diet app. But that might be a typical keto day. Here's some frequent keto mistakes and questions. So the top three mistakes I'd say are not enough plants, not eating enough plants. I would say now, it's a little different than our ebook, but not enough restriction is a huge one. Too much protein is another really big one. because too much protein can turn to sugar. So if you're not, you know, frequently vigorously exercising, you might be doing too much protein. So replace some of that protein with fat. You definitely don't need a protein shake and, you know, protein with each meal and just protein, protein, protein if you're trying to lose weight. If you are exercising often, you are breaking down protein, then you need a lot of it. So if you're, or a lot more, I should say. Still, most people overdo it, but if you are lifting weights, if you're doing any long-term endurance exercising, anything with a high intensity, your protein requirements go up on a keto diet. But let's say you are, you know, you want to lose 50 pounds, you sit at a desk every day, you're starting to exercise a little bit more, your protein requirements are going to be really, really low. Okay, so most people are overdoing their protein, and that's one of the most common mistakes. But some of the most common questions, how do I start? Well, you start by just measuring your net carbs and tracking that and looking at that. Okay, so that's how you start. Start by increasing your good fats, your avocados. Let's say you're coming from a standard American diet. You know, you might want to transition to like a paleo diet first and then transition to a keto diet. If you're already eating a real food, paleo type, grain-free diet, start to increase your good fats, start to measure your net carbs. And the best way, I mean, honestly, the best way of how to start is start with fasting. You know, let's say you're watching this webinar and you're like, man, I want to do this, but I don't think that I'm ready. Well, start right now by not eating. And that's what we always say about fasting is all you do is nothing. And it's not easy. You're going to have some cravings, but you know, go 2-3 days. You're going to survive, and use those 2-3 days to start researching and start meal planning and start prepping, getting your free range eggs, getting your avocados, getting your, you know, olive oils, your avocado oils, your MCT oils, getting your coconut flour, your almond flour, getting your meal planning and prepping going. But you don't need anything to start. Start by fasting. If you start with a 3-4 day fast, it's going to cut off a dramatic amount of time of keto adapting. So remember I said that, you know, if you're just following the ketogenic diet, 3-4 weeks to adapt is very, very typical. For some people, it's even longer, but about 3 weeks is when your body will start being a fat burner. If you start off with fasting, it's going to take 3-4 days. So if you do a 3-4 day fast, then you start adding back in, you know, you eat a couple of eggs, you start doing some MCT, you start doing, you know, some avocado, you slowly start adding back in calories, but you start on the low carbon, the 10 grams of carbs per day, maybe, you're going to transition really, really quickly. After you've done this for about a year or so, you can get away with 100 grams of net carbs per day. And even higher if you're an athlete, but you have to measure to know. So that's a pretty frequently asked question, you know, how do I start? Because that is, you know, the biggest thing is it's intimidating, but tell yourself, I'm gonna fast a day, 2 days, 3 days. And in those 3 days, I'm gonna create a plan. I'm gonna get into my fat burning mode and I'm gonna do this. So I'm not fat adapting, why? You're eating too many carbs. Sorry, I had to take a drink. You're eating too many carbs and you don't know it. Sometimes the apps, sometimes the websites that I've seen, they're not really accurate reflection of the net carbs based on what I see on the nutrition facts. So you're not fat adapting because you're eating too many carbs. You should go into ketosis if you are restricting enough. But this is another time where you want to keep your body guessing. So I've had patients that can barely break into 0.5, 0.6 on their keto meter, and they're being pretty strict. What we'll do is we'll take them off the keto diet, start doing more of a paleo diet, not really counting your carbs, but still not eating grains, not eating breads, not eating sugars, but just stop trying so hard. Give your body a break, go back in a month, 2 months later, your body will go into ketosis easier. And so cycling and keeping your body guessing is a really important way. The other way is, you know, say you're doing a strict keto diet, you're 3 weeks in, you're still hitting the 0.4, 0.5 on your finger pricks, do a 2-day fast. Do a 2-3-day fast. You know, we say that 4 is the magic number because so many people feel amazing at day 4. Days 1, they're okay. 2, 3, they're like feeling like crap. And then day 4, they're like, oh my gosh, I'm going to go longer. And that's because their ketones start to rise. And if you're already in mild ketosis and you do a couple day fast, that's going to really kickstart your body into stronger ketosis. Check your ketone levels at the end of your fast. See where you're at. Make sure you're still doing sea salt. Listen to our podcast on fasting. Learn a little bit more about fasting before you just, you know, before you jump into it. But after you've made that decision to do that, you have plenty of time to research about it. You don't need your sea salt increase in the first 12 hours. So just start fasting, start researching, start learning what you need to do to fast, and talk to us, talk to me, get a real health coaching, how to fast, how to implement the keto diet, because some people do have trouble keto adapting and breaking in. How about this one? I'm not losing weight. Why? That's another, you know, frequent mistake, too many calories. So when you look at fat versus carbs or protein, fat has over twice as many calories as carbs or protein. Fat has 9 calories per gram, kilocalories. Carbs and protein have 4. So over twice as much fuel. That's why fat is such an efficient fuel source. That's why your body can go for a long time on its fat stores. But if you just trade out, you know, your gram per gram carb heavy meal for a fat heavy meal, you are getting a lot more calories. So you do need to track this to some degree. I'm not a big fan of calorie restriction or calorie excess, but you do need to track this and know how many calories you're taking in. And once again, if you aren't losing weight, a great thing to follow is that 5-1-1 rule. To stabilize your blood sugar, keep your body guessing on those intermittent fasting days. You can calorie restrict a little bit, but you want to throw in that feast day to let your body know that it's not starving. And one feast day, and you can switch that up. You can do 2 feast days a week. You can do 2 fast days a week. You can switch that up. But 5-1-1 is a great rule to follow if you're not losing weight, and do a little bit of calorie restriction. But keep the high fat, keep the ketogenic, and make sure you get that feast day. How do you eat out at restaurants? Really, really hard. So like there's only a couple places that I eat for lunch, Chipotle and a place here in Salt Lake called Redmond Farms or Real Foods Market. I get a bunless grass-fed burger and I get all the toppings. You know, I'll get onions, I'll get tomatoes, even though they're fairly high carb, but I get, you know, a local raw cheddar on top, or pepper jack rather, excuse me, and get the grass-fed burger. So, you know, that you can get that anywhere. You can start to get bunless burgers. You know, you can get them at Carl's Jr. You can get them at fast food places. Bunless burger, you can get an unwich at Jimmy John's, but, you know, a lot of the other stuff that's in there is just crap. The mayo, and, you know, I'm not encouraging those, but how can you eat out? Salads are a great way. Ask people about their oils. But the number one thing is, remember, restriction. So just less is more. You know, if you just aren't eating the bread, aren't drinking, you know, 2 beers with your dinner, aren't eating a burger with, you know, big bun on it, you can, you know, flirt the line a little bit. And if you're going to be eating out at night, you know, maybe that's a day that you restrict a little bit more earlier in the day, because you know it's going to be tough. You ate an omelet for lunch with no grams of net carbs, and you're still, you know, close to 0 grams when you go out for dinner. You're going to have a 40-gram net carb dinner and still be okay, you know, the next day, and not really be, you know, destroying your chances of getting into ketosis. So really hard question. The answer is it's really hard, but it's possible. So, you know, look at the menu, and places today especially, they are willing to, you know, change things around for you. So order things on the side, have different things taken off, add olives, add avocado, get a side of olive oil, and a lot of different things you can do. Some people I know can travel with MCT oil, and then put MCT oil over anything to just stay in ketosis while they're traveling. How about this one? What about ketone supplements? And that is something that is kind of a gray area to me, because I'm not very against ketone supplementation, but at the same time, for my typical patient or client, or somebody that's interested in weight loss or not like a high level athlete or things, it's a pretty gray area. I don't think that you need them, but I think they can be a really useful tool. But at the same time, I think that they're marketed, you know, kind of irresponsibly. It does not get you into ketosis, nutritional ketosis. It does put ketones in your bloodstream by taking a ketone supplement. And I'll show you one right here that is Keto OX from Prove It. And I actually, you know, I'm not, you know, I have them here. So I'm not against this product. I use it, but you need to use it along with a diet. I don't use it every day. I'm not interested in weight loss or burning my own fat, but it can kind of prime your ketone producing system. So if you have, you know, a cheat night or a cheat weekend, you can kind of, you know, use fasting, use ketone supplements as a very useful tool to get back into ketosis quicker. But you want to be producing your own ketones if you want your body to be burning its own fat. You can still get ketones in your bloodstream. You can still get the brain effects. You can still feel, you know, the great feeling of being in ketosis, but you're not burning your own fat. You can shut down your own keto pathways if you do those too much. You want to be getting there naturally, but they can be used as a tool. So it's a slippery slope there. I do use them, like I said, but I think it's really important to use them, you know, with somebody like myself as a health coach and as a physician, to use them. You have to do it with the diet. What I cannot stand is somebody using ketone while not doing the diet fully, or even kind of flirting the line with the diet. You have to do the diet first, and you can't be spiking insulin and then spiking ketones at the same time. I don't think that that's a good formula. And lastly, can kids do this diet? Absolutely, kids can do this diet. I don't think that they necessarily need to be strict, but, you know, they can eat a lot of high-fat foods, but they can also be in ketosis with a higher carb load. So I think that a good real food paleo diet is great, you know, for kids. But yeah, that's what it was used for first, was childhood epilepsies, and it is great for their brain health. So to cycle kids in and out of ketosis, you know, I don't think the kids should be doing any fasting or even, you know, really intermittent fasting. I think that, you know, getting three meals a day is good for kids. Maybe a couple of days of intermittent fasting, but they'll usually let you know. But keeping a low carb diet, I think, is really important for anybody. Whether or not you're trying to go into ketosis, whether or not you're trying to, you know, get brain fuel, whether or not you're trying to lose weight, regardless, I think that a low carb, grain free diet is by far the best. But, you know, you might not be in necessarily ketosis on that diet. So I don't think it's necessary for kids, but absolutely they can do it. And let's say you have a kid that's, you know, 10, 11, 12, that started to put on some weight in the massively growing category of overweight kids, of already insulin resistant kids, of already high pre-diabetic blood sugar kids. What about a ketogenic diet for a month? They're going to reverse many of those conditions, and you know, you're going to stop that progression. So absolutely, you can cycle them in and out of ketosis, and that is, you know, one of the things that keto diet is used for as well. You can reverse diabetes, you can reverse poor blood sugar control. Your body can heal and it can change those things. Now, I'm not guaranteeing every single person, I'm not saying that everybody is going to go out and reverse their diabetes, but if you do a ketogenic diet, you absolutely can. So learn more, continue to read, you know, more of our stuff, continue to watch more videos on the ketogenic diet, on the benefits of it, but make sure that you follow, you know, a very healthy, non-toxic version of the ketogenic diet. Plant-based, real food, organically pasture-raised animals, eggs. If you're going to do any dairy, make sure it's raw, organic, grass-fed, the highest quality on your animal products. And yes, it will be a little bit more expensive, but it's going to be worth it in the long run. You can't be doing a bunch of, you know, pork and bacon and, you know, shellfish and toxic and still inflammatory foods on a ketogenic diet. You can get into ketosis, but you're hurting your health long term. So I think that that is something that's really important. The last thing I'm going to do is I'm going to put my email address up there. Feel free to email me with any questions. You can watch this webinar again. You can download the ebook. You can start to learn more about this keto diet. But really, the number one thing I would say is to just jump in. Whether or not you want the brain fuel, whether or not you want to avoid chronic diseases like cancer, like Alzheimer's, like dementia, whether or not you want to reduce oxidative stress, whether or not you want to lose 50 to 100 pounds, no matter what your goals are, or if you just want to be, you know, kind of the best version of yourself, going in and out of ketosis, one of the most useful tools that I've ever seen. And it's not a product that you buy or that you take. It's something that anybody can do. And if you think about this, this is the last thing that I'll add. Our ancestors, when you think about a paleo diet or paleo concept, our ancestors would go in and out of ketosis at different times when they didn't have access to food, when, you know, plants didn't grow in the winter, so you had to eat more animal, more high fat. Then, you know, a lot of different cultures have what's called starvation spring, where they're waiting for the plants to sprout. And so you go in and out of ketosis. You can use this. You don't need to do it all the time. You don't need to do it for the next, you know, year. You can go in and out and start to use it as a tool to keep your cells healthy, to increase longevity, but to also just, you know, feel the best that you've really honestly ever felt. So let me put up my email address again right there. And so email me, Dr. Taylor, at The Real Health Resource. If this is something that you have questions on, feel free to email me. But if you need a coach, if you need some guidance, if you need a team to help you through this, I think that everybody does. On www.realhealthresource.com, you can sign up for our Real Health Coaching. And what that is health coaching, where we meet via Skype, via Google Hangouts, via video call twice a month. And in the meantime, you get unlimited email access to me regarding your history, regarding where your health is at, regarding your goals and the direction that you want to head, so that we can be your coach. Most people out there, they don't need another medication. They don't need another doctor. They don't really even need another cookbook. They need a coach and someone to help them put the pieces together for their health. So we offer very affordable health coaching packages. It also gets you savings on all of our supplements, on all of our lab testing. You get automatic savings when you're a member of Real Health Coaching. So www.realhealthresource.com. Email me, drtaylor@realhealthresource.com, and check out the other webinars, download the Ketogenic Diet ebook, and get started on this today, and let me know the results.